Hello, my name is Lars Schlieper, and I will present to you the paper Toward Quantum Large-Scale Password Guessing on Real-World Distributions. This is a joint work with Markus Dürmuth, Maximilian Goller, Philip Markert, and Alex Mai. In this paper, we are looking into the scenario where passwords are still highly biased in the future, even if powerful quantum computers emerge. For this, we assume the setting that we have access to a password leak L with samples LU, which contains the user U, the salt of the user U, and the password hash of the user U, which is the hash volume of SU combined with the password of the user U. Additionally, we assume knowledge about the passwords and the distribution, so that we not only know which passwords are used in the leak, but also how frequently they are used. And at last, we have access to a powerful quantum computer, which not only can encode the users as well as the used password, but can also evaluate the underlying hash function that is used in the password leak. We then tried to answer the following two questions. Can we combine the advantage of the knowledge about the password distribution with the usage of a quantum computer? And if so, how fast can we determine a certain fraction of all user password pairs? For this, we looked into real-world password distributions. Normally, passwords are used for user authentication in the internet and should be selected long and uniform distributed. But this is in reality not the case. If we rank the password by their frequency, we get a plot that looks a little bit like this plot on the right. We see that the low-ranked passwords are used quite often, but also that there are many passwords that are only used a few times. But however, the few passwords with low ranked or the many users that use one of these few passwords are the problem in this case. To see that even better what happens in this lower ranked of the passwords, let us consider the log-log scale plot. This distribution occurs since users tend to simple passwords, like 123456 or A times A. Easy to remember ones, like the page name where the password is used on, or the simple password password, or passwords that are related to the platform and the language, like Amur for French dating platforms or shopping for the platform Amazon. This bias of the distribution also increased in the length of the password, since if the password length increase, the users have more problems to remember complex passwords. Let us come back to the plot on the right. This is indeed the plot to the LinkedIn leak from 2012. With roughly 160 million users and 60 million different passwords. We can see that the plot is nearly a line in the log-log scale, so that we can it approximate via the SIP distribution, which is also only a line in the log-log scale. The SIP distribution probability is given by a scaling factor times 1 over I to the power of S, where I represent in our case the rank of the password, and S gives us the slope of the line that is in the log-log scale. We can see that a slope of roughly 0.777 fits our LinkedIn lead at best. Let us have a closer look at this distribution. In the log-log scale, it is hard to compare how many users are using only a certain fraction of passwords. So let us put this in a little bit perspective. We see on this plot that nearly 50% of all users use only 10% of the different password. Or in the more extreme case, 0.007% of the top-ranked passwords accounting for 10% of all users, which means that by only checking this small fraction of all passwords for the users, we already get a huge fraction of 10% of all user password pairs. On the other side, we see the long tail of passwords, where we have roughly 60% of the passwords that are used only a few times, in the most cases only once. But that are only accounting for 25% of all users. To summarize this, we can see that we can take a huge advantage out of the knowledge about the password distribution. Before we come to our attacks, let us look at the quantum side. In the quantum setting, we can take advantage out of Grover's algorithm for unstructured search. Grover's algorithm can speed up the search for a specific element that is marked by a function. Given a search space, and a mark and a marking function. Grover's algorithm can find this marked element with only a square root of the size of the square root many evaluations of the marking function. To put it in some perspective, if we assume we have a search space of 10,000 elements. Classically, we have an average to test 5,000 elements before we find before we find the marked element. In the quantum setting, we require only 100 evaluations of this f function to find the marked element. In our paper, we use the marking function f, which, given a password and a leak sample, evaluates to 1 if and only if the hash value of the salt out of the leak sample together with the password guess is the same as the hash value of the salt of the password leak together with the password of the password leak, or the third entrance of the password leak. To make our analysis comparable between different hash functions, we used as cost unit the numbers of hash evaluations that are required. Note that for every evaluation of f, we have to evaluate the hash function one time. To sum it up, in the quantum setting, we can use Grover's to get a square root speed up for the uniform search, without even the knowledge about the distribution of the passwords. Let us now come to our attacks. First of all, we want to find one user password pair. We use for this the approximation of the distribution for ease of understanding. And also, let us say that the parameter s is not 0.777, but 0.75, so that it's easier to calculate. This is even a worse distribution for the attacks, since it is near on the uniform distribution. So first of all, we want to find classically one user password pair. For this, the best way is to use the password with the highest frequency, or the password with rank 1, and look for random users until we find a user with this password. This means that we need roughly 1 over the probability that a user have used the first password, many evaluations of the hash function before we find a user password pair. This means that we need roughly 4 square root of n evaluations to find a user password pair. Or for our example leak, roughly 90 evaluations. To put it in some perspective, a brute force attack without knowledge about the distribution would require an average 30 million hash evaluations before we find a user password pair. On the quantum side, we could use Grover's algorithm. With this, we only require the square root of n evaluations to find a user password pair. Or in our case, nearly 7,750 evaluations. Note that we are better than the brute force case in the classical setting by roughly a square root, but worse than the distribution setting for the first password. It is also to note that it is for Grover irrelevant if we use for a user to a fixed password or a password to a fixed user. In both cases, the same average runtime occur. In our paper, we now looked into a combination attack of both. If we combine both techniques, so we start Grover with the knowledge about the distribution and look for a user with a password 1, we can further decrease the number of needed hash evaluations to nearly the 8th square root of n, or in our case, roughly 9 evaluations. To make it a little bit more comparable, let us for a moment assume that we have 100 million passwords. In this case, a brute force attack would require an average 50 million guesses or evaluations of the hash function. The Grover attack would only require a square root of n, so 10,000 evaluations of the hash function. The classical attack, with the knowledge about the password distribution, would further decrease this to the 4 square root of n, or 100 evaluations of the hash function. And with the combined attack, we only require the 8 square root of n, or 10 evaluations of the hash function. We are now interested in finding a certain fraction of all user password pairs. For this, we could iterate the previous approach. But since we can't assume that enough users have the first password, we have also to consider some more passwords. So we have to repeat the previous approach for the first k passwords, where we can estimate the number k by the fraction to the power of n times n. In our example, for, let's say, c equal to 10%, That would mean that we have to consider the first 6,000 passwords of the password leak. Note here that already the 1,000th password has only a probability of 1 over 15,000 to occur, which means that a classical attack, even if we know the distribution, would here require more hash evaluations to find the next password than a Grover search attack. Since brute force and Grover don't use the password distribution, they are not really affected by the fraction C. Classically, we have roughly to check the first k password for every user, which would result in an average cost per user password pair of t to the power of 3 times n. Or in our example of t equal to 10%, this would require 60,000 hash evaluations per user password pair. On the other side, if we used our combined approach, we require still a square root of k times u hash evaluations in total, but with average cost of only a square root of c to the power of 3 times n. For our example case of 10%, this means that also the number of hash evaluations that are required for a user password pair goes down by roughly a square root, which would be 250 hash evaluations. We then simulated our attacks. The brute force attack, the classical attack, the Grover attack, as well as our combined attack. For a leak that is distributed like a linked-linked leak, but in contrast to the linked-linked leak is sorted, as well as for a leak that is truly SIP distributed with a parameter of 0.777. The results can be seen in the following table. The numbers in this table represent the average required hash evaluations per user to find a certain fraction of all user password pairs. Here, idle refers to the case where brute force is used or the Grover algorithm without knowledge about the password distribution. We can already see that the SIP distribution is a quite good approximation of the LinkedIn password leak and that it gives a good estimation on how many hash evaluations in average are required in the LinkedIn password leak. We can also see that the graded adventures can be achieved for a small fraction of target users. Later, the many good password pairs turn the tide, so that if we want to find all user password pairs, the advantage of the knowledge about the password distribution nearly disappear. To put this in a little bit more perspective, let us assume for a second that each hash evaluation requires roughly 1 second, classically as well as quantumly. Then the numbers for the 10% case boils down that in average we find a user password pair via brute force in 2 years, which means that the passwords are quite safe. If we have knowledge about the distribution of the password, we can classically already achieve a time of only 10 hours to find a user password pair in average. On the quantum side, however, we find already with Grover's algorithm, without knowledge about the password distribution, a user password pair in roughly 2 hours. But if we combine the quantum computer with the knowledge about the password distribution, we can reduce this time of user to only 3 minutes per user password pair. This is in fact a huge difference. In an ideal case, where the passwords are perfectly distributed, an attacker would require an average 2 years to find a user password pair. Where in the worst setting, with use of a quantum computer and the knowledge about the password distribution, the attacker would only require like 3 minutes for every user password pair. Let us summarize our results. We have shown in this paper that we can combine the advantage of a quantum computer with the advantage of knowledge about the password distribution. More precisely, we can carry over a square root of the speed up from the password distribution to the quantum setting. This means that quantum computers could be an even greater threat in the future to passwords. But we can prepare us for this. For example, we could use password managers more often. With the use of password managers, passwords could be longer and uniform distributed, so that there is no advantage anymore from the password distribution. On the server side, we could use costly to compute hash functions, so that the time that quantum computers are powerful enough to evaluate these hash functions are delayed. With this in mind, the threat of quantum computers in the future might be manageable if we prepare us, so that we still could use passwords in the future. Thank you for your attention.